else. In these verses, you don't find him saying, ministry is this. So that's my understanding of what he was trying to communicate. The first thing is that in verse 37, you see that he introduces a need. Okay? It says, if any man is thirsty, there's a need there. So you don't have ministry where there is no need. The very thing that makes ministry possible is the need to provide for the answers to the cry of men. It is like those of you that have studied business. They tell you that business is about discovering people's needs and being able to provide solutions to that. So if you don't discover the problem, you are obviously not going to be in business. Because the essence of business is to provide solutions to people's problems. Ministry is like that. As a matter of fact, I'm saying this, ministry is a business. It's kingdom business. So first, there has to be a need. And then secondly, there has to be supply. Men are in need of something. And you that claims to be doing ministry, you have what they're looking for, ready for supply. He that is thirst, he says, let him come unto me. I love Jesus because he doesn't want to suggest that you can try to look for solution elsewhere. He says, I have it. If you're thirst, come to me. I'm not sure about other people. But I'm saying if you come to me, there's going to be a solution. But the basic line is that there is a need. Someone is thirst. And then number two, there is you that has the solution. Look at Isaiah. Now, this shouldn't mean to you in any way whatsoever that I'm trying to say good preaching is not necessary. Good teaching, good prophesying. That's not what I'm trying to say. But my point is, if we put our emphasis on that, we're going to raise good performers that don't achieve the purpose of ministry. I was a few years ago reading a certain article about someone who was writing about a certain minister, and he was supposed to be writing about the achievement of that great man. And to my surprise, he started by indicating the number of sermons that the man preached. And it was a big number. And the first thing that now dawns into the hearts of men when they hear that number is, wow, the man saved God alone. But the question is, what was the content of the message? Now, that's not to downplay the efforts. But my point is, we don't judge ministry success by the amount of activities that have been carried out, but by the efficiency. How successful has the goal been reached? It means there has to be a goal. Many are so curious, they have found themselves into multitudes of activities that they don't even know why they're doing. So there's no drive, there's no passion, there's no push. There is no ground. Even if you ask them, why do you do the things that you do, they are not going to answer. Many are on the pulpits every week, but they're so curious what they're trying to achieve. And if you are under mentorship with someone that doesn't know what he wants to do with you, chances are you will not make any progress. Because progress is not defined by how many things have been done, but how closer have you kept moving towards the target. So there has to be a vision. There's a vision of the teacher, and then there's a vision of the students. And what the students get is determined by what the teacher prepares. And that's why when it comes to the issues of God putting his church under mentorship, makes us think people should come to us. Because people are not stupid. They are not going to be wasting time going where they will not find solutions. We are pastoring and doing ministry in a very difficult generation. We are pastoring in a generation that requires signs and proofs more than intelligence of words. So our ministries must be based on evidence. Nice talk is not enough. It has to be a ministry that consistently provides solutions to men's needs. And I think that's why the gospel of many now has been materialized. Because that's the only way to get their attention. We tell them, you come, your doors will open, you come, you'll be healed. And because these men are coming in the first place, you don't expect carnal men to be pursuing spiritual things. So our first indicator, even as we are publicizing what we do, the first things we are marketing are the things that people are looking for, which is not bad. But if in so doing we miss the target, then it means we've lost the vision of Jesus. But the vision of Jesus for ministry is not passive, such that people just come and hear talk and then off they go. No. The idea is that in the words that you speak, there has to be solution. Are we together? An invitation to supply because there is a need. So write this down. Ministry begins at the identification of man's need. If you haven't identified people's needs and you have a solution to that, you have no business whatsoever with ministry. Now please listen to me very well again. That's a general definition of ministry. An administration of solutions to people's problems. But here's what I need everybody to hear. And my prayer is many ministers of the gospel should access this. How did God come about the idea of ministry? Because we're going to define ministry from God's standpoint. How did God come about the idea of ministry? If we are accurate, that ministry begins at the identification of man's problems. What was the human problem that God saw that needed a solution? Because that is where ministry with God started. I said something several months ago about teaching at church, and I want to bring that up as a basis of our definition of ministry. I say the greatest human problem that has ever been is the problem of sin. Okay? That's the biggest problem that has ever been. Hebrews in chapter number 9. Let's see if we go 2 or 3 sessions with our teaching, if we are still going to be interested in being ministry. Or if we can boldly say, forget about preaching. I know you've been doing it well. Forget about prophesying. I know it's been happening. But now consistency with the vision of the master. That's what I'm trying to do. Hebrews chapter number 9. Looking from verse 27. Let's take it from verse 26. For then must he oft have suffered since the foundation of the world. But now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed unto men, somebody say men. Once to die, but after this the judgment, that's not a full stop, that's a colon. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many. And unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. He declares is unto men. So as long as you are a man, it doesn't matter how good or bad you think you are, you are under subjection to this judgment. He says, as it is appointed unto men. So before we come to what Jesus did about this appointment, let's understand what was about this. He says, when Jesus walked on this earth, he found an appointment to humanity. And the appointment was death and then judgment. It means every man that is born into this world before Jesus died was born into an eternal appointment of death and judgment. And you are not going to be able to escape that. Because it is appointed unto men. This is where many preachers got the idea that every man must die. Because they read it that way. It is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. So every man must die. But that's not accurate, because he says, so Christ, in other words, since men had to die and then face judgment, then Christ was offered in their place. It means Christ took the place of men. But before he did, all men were appointed to death and judgment. This is the greatest human crisis that has ever been there. And it's a crisis because no man could have saved himself from that. Listen, when we talk about a crisis, we're not talking about inadequacy of something. We're not talking about unavailability of something. We are talking about a situation where it's not even possible to outsource answers. Such that if you're ever going to have any solution, it must come from other sources, not within the context of your provisions. So if you are ever going to have a solution, it has entered into your realm from some other realm. That's why it's called a crisis. Fuel crisis is not solved by the provision within the nation. There has to be an external help coming in. So it means within the context of man's ability and provisions to men, there was no escape for sin. Greatest human tragedy ever that did not allow men even to be distinguished. Whether you have lived right or you have lived wrong, the end of every man was the same. Your background, your race, your generational background, it never mattered. As long as you were a man, the appointment was death and then judgment. He says, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of men. But my focus now is to understand the extent of that crisis, because that's what made ministry, God's standpoint, a possibility. So man is in a problem of sin. He cannot bring himself out. Then God says, I have an answer. Romans chapter number 8. Or maybe let's begin with a solution by one man, sin. Singular again. Surprise. Jesus didn't come to take care of the sins of men. Meaning wrongdoings of men. That was not why Jesus came. I'll show you many verses now. We are understanding what ministry is. And we want to understand ministry from God's standpoint. And we are saying ministry begins at the identification of human problem, which you think you have a solution with. Or you are sure you need to be sure. Okay? So we're trying to understand, where did this idea of ministry from God's standpoint come into existence? Because the very coming of Jesus to die for men is ministry. He came to fulfill a ministry. The prophet that came to introduce him, John the Baptist, came with a ministry. The prophets before him came with a ministry. But the interesting thing is, all ministries were all pointing to Jesus. Because Jesus was the one, according to the book of Hebrews, that was going to have a more excellent ministry. That means a more complete ministry. Such that all the ministries of the Old Testament will be bound together and be defined as one ministry. I love the way Peter calls it. He says, the prophecy of the Old Testament, not the prophecies. It means everything the prophet said in the Old Testament can be summarized into one thing. I'm going to show that to you in a moment. So no prophet had a peculiar message. He was not allowed to have a special, like we say in our day, I have a special message given by God. Another one, I have my own message. You don't have your own message. You may have your own, the Bible says it this way. It says, God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake unto the fathers in time past, he says, by the prophets and by diverse manners. So the only one who was talking is God, and the only voice and word of God is Christ. So God spake by the prophets, but using many means. So you would be thinking, because I have my own way of then it means I have my own message. You know, the message is the same. What is different are the ways of communicating it. You will find a prophet that never had to come and begin to proclaim that God is saying, you guys have gone into spiritual adultery. The only thing he had to do was to marry a prostitute. That was the manner that God chose to use Hosea in. So diverse manners. In many ways, in many times. But the same man speaks. He says, as by one man, sin entered into the world. And death by sin. The wages of sin is death. You don't find death except when there is sin. And like I've said, not sins. Jesus didn't come for the sins. He didn't come for the sins of the world. Are we still here? Okay. Go to chapter number 8. Same book of Romans. Now please bear with me. It is almost going to look like we are discussing about sin, but we're not. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ. I'm reading verse 1. Jesus walked not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. I'm looking for verse 3 specific. Look at it. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh. Look at this now. God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemn sin in the flesh. He says, God sent his Son to do what the law could not do. And then specifically say, he sent his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. Jesus came. Making it clear, Jesus didn't come for death. He didn't come to deal with death. I was thinking about this some other time today. And I realized it's interesting that Jesus didn't even come for the devil. The devil was not his mission. He was not interested to fight the devil in whatsoever way possible. If he ever finds himself fighting the devil, it means the devil has stood on his way to dealing with sin. Why? Because the Bible defines sin as the hand of the enemy. It says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy. And the hand of the enemy is sin. So Jesus came for sin. 1 John chapter number 3. 1 John chapter number 3. I want you to see works of the devil. So what are the works of the devil in context? Sin. So Jesus came for sin. Jesus came for sin. Matthew chapter number 1 and verse 21. And shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. Can you read the other part for me? 1, 2, 3, go. For he shall save his people from what? From their sins. Now there's no reason why you should have put Paul there. But remember that the gospels were written by men. It was a testimony of men. So there were human errors. And if I was the one writing, I was going to write, for he shall save men from their sin. Because men didn't have a problem with sins, but sin. By one man, what entered is not sins, is sin. That's the foundation of God's ministry. So, the coming of Jesus was going to be to save men from their sin. That's why he came. I hope we're still here. Okay. Look at the book of John. Bethabara beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. It says, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin. There's a reason why Jesus called John the Baptist the greatest of all prophets. Have you ever thought about it? Have you ever thought about the fact that John never performed miracles, at least as recorded in the Bible? Ever thought of the fact that John never raised the dead, at least as recorded in the Bible? If he did, the Holy Ghost didn't find it necessary for that to be documented. And yet the same Spirit saw it necessary for the miracles of Elijah. Miracles of all these prophets. And yet Jesus was going to come and say, of all men that were born, prophets that were born of women, John the Baptist is the greatest. Question. What makes John the greatest of all prophets? There's Moses. Don't forget that. There's Elijah. Isn't it the very same Jesus that said that John was the Elijah that was to come? And he calls him the greatest of all. What made John the greatest prophet of all of them? It is the revelation that he brought. All prophets said, there shall be the Christ. They pointed at Christ. Or rather, they were pointing to Christ. John is the only prophet that pointed at Christ and said, this is him. Behold the Lamb of God. He didn't prophesy. John didn't prophesy. And that's why the Bible says the law and the prophets prophesied it until John. John was not a prophesying prophet. John was a revealing prophet. He's a prophet that came to reveal that which was prophesied. He was a prophet of substance. He was the prophet of fulfillment. And Jesus looks at the ministry. He says, make no mistakes about it. This man is the greatest of all. All prophets talked about, in their day at least, remission of sin, or rather, atonement of sin, covering of sin. John talked about the Lamb of God that is going to take away the sin of the whole world. Jesus looks at that. He says, tell me if there is any prophet greater. Now, the criteria criteria on which Jesus is describing a great prophet, a great minister, is not ministry activities. Let's establish this fact and move to the last one. Ministry begins at a place where human problem is identified. So the ministry we are calling forth today is the ministry of God in Christ. And the foundation of it is God's desire, prompted by his love, to send his son, die for the sin of the whole world, which was the global human crisis, to save men from sin. And so that ministry of Christ, birthed from the love of God, that ministry is what makes our ministries available. And it means our ministries must be built on that. It means we have a ministry to provide answers to human problems that were a result of sin. Our goal is not to remove sin. Our goal is to publicize the defeat of sin by the works of Christ. And to demonstrate the evidence that sin and its effects have been conquered. That's where the healing comes in. That's where the defeat of poverty by the word comes in. That's where the defeat of affliction comes in. It all centers on the fulfilled ministry of God in Christ that was introduced because of the problem of sin. He says, he that is thirsty, let him come. You only invite men that are in need to a place of solution. That's ministry. So when you say I'm a minister, it means you have identified human problems. It means you have a solution. And now you are inviting them to come. He says, come ye and drink. Come and buy. And then he says something very powerful. He says, he that believes upon me, as the scripture had said, out of his belly shall flow out rivers of living water. It means the provision of these solutions, ladies and gentlemen, they don't come from the cars that you drive. They don't come from your possessions. They don't come from your suit. They come from your belly. It means a minister is the man inside the spirit. That's where you're going to find Paul in Romans chapter number 1. He says, and I thank God whom I serve with my spirit. That's where ministry is. That's the belly out of which rivers of living water are going to flow. So a minister is a possessor of a divine treasure that serves as a solution. When you are a minister, you are a problem solver. And that's why every minister must have a heart for people. Because you're not coming to deal with animal problems, you're coming to deal with human problems. So you must have a heart for people. It's not even something you need to begin to develop. It should have been there in the first place. Because that's what qualifies you to go to men. Glory to God. At the identification of human problems and at a place of the conviction that you, the minister, have answers to that. Let me bring it down to our practical level. Why then are we having churches? Why are we having ministries? We're trying to set up online ministries, want people to hear us. of Job in the past. That's why we now preach rumors of God. There's something else Job said that I'm out. When calamity befell him, he stood up and he gave a false testimony. It's in the Bible. He said, the Lord gave, the Lord has taken, blessed be his name. If you read and from there you stop there, you're going to carry in your head the mentality that God gives and God takes. And then he said in chapter number 3, if not 4, he stands, you can tell the man was confused. He stands and he says, that which I have always feared has befallen me. Oh, now it explains why things have happened. So now God's character is now being justified. Slowly. And then in the last chapters, he said, I have known you by the rumors of men. But now, I have seen the truth. It means all the other things I've been writing in other chapters were based from rumors that I heard about you. I heard you, you give and you take. So when it happened, I justified the rumors of God. Many are preaching rumors today, but they're scripturally backed and supported. That's why every doctrine available has got many scripture backups for it. And that's why Paul says, study, study. He's telling his son, study, study. Don't just find where to preach from. He said, that's not a discipline of a minister. He says, study to show thyself approved, not unto men. Imagine that you need to be approved before God, before he can send you. He says, how shall they preach if they have not been sent? So how many can boldly stand and say, the Lord has sent me. He that God has sent speaketh the words of God. He doesn't come with rumors. How many can stand on a platform, whether it's of 20 people or 1,000, it makes no difference. But you can stand and say, God has sent me. And according to Jesus, the evidence of him that God has sent is not miracles first. It's that he speaks the words of God. For that God giveth not the spirit with measure unto him. Then as they preached, the Lord, working with them, confirmed their words with signs following. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved by God with signs. Wonders. Signs and wonders are a token of approval. Approving what? Ministry. What is ministry? The flow of waters, words of life. He says, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. That's ministry. Something that you carry, something that you possess, something that you have to give to others. You're not a minister if you haven't heard the cry of the nations. When Jesus walked on the earth, he heard the cry of all humanity. Save us from eternal damnation. No prophet was ever saved, oh dear God. And that's why the Bible says when Jesus died, the graves were opened. No man ever went to heaven. The graves were opened. And the Bible says at his resurrection, it says when the graves opened, the bodies of them that died came together. And that doesn't mean people were raised. It says the bodies came together. That's what Ezekiel saw. I want you to understand the prophecy of Ezekiel chapter number 37. The prophecy was not about bones of real physical people that died. Because when you read further, you're going to realize that it says, why are people talking about Israel, that Israel has lost hope? It was a message of resurrection. It was fulfilled in those days. Now, Ezekiel's prophecy was that when he began to speak, bone came together, bone to its body. Flesh came, sinews came. And then the bodies were there arranged, but then the Bible says they were lifeless. And then there had to be another rhema that came again and said, prophesy unto the four winds and say, oh ye breath. And then when Ezekiel began to prophesy breath, that's when the bodies that came together first were now raised, fulfilled at the death of Jesus. When he died, bones came together, sinews came together, but there was no life. Why? When he went to the grave of Lazarus, these sisters were crying. Jesus said, if you had come here earlier, my brother would have not died. You know what Jesus said? He said, don't worry. Did I tell you that if you believe in God, your brother shall live again? He said, I know he shall live at the resurrection day. He says, the problem is you are bound to a day. I am the resurrection and the life. Spare me the day. In other words, the day of resurrection has come. I am the resurrection and the life. It means resurrection doesn't mean life. Why?
son. This day
have I begotten you.
And then Jesus came alive as the firstborn. He says, in bringing to glory many sons, it was befitting for the Father to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. He says, Jesus became the first begotten of the dead, the firstborn among many brethren. He became the firstborn when he was raised. And then, after then only, could all these other prophets be raised. And the Bible says they were seen in the holy place. And then they disappeared. That's the first rapture that ever happened. Those guys went. They have put on immortality. They went. Jesus made it happen. This man was more than a prophet. So when he came, he heard the cries of prophets that were in Abraham's bosom. That's why when he came in his ministry days, he is the one who made reference to a place called Abraham's bosom. Because he knew at the present time, no man goes to heaven. Men go to Abraham's bosom. But right now, a message of Abraham's bosom is invalidated. And I've heard preachers pray that way. Give us in the bosom of Abraham. Did you hear what sounds good? Chicato. Doesn't make sense. You see, when you don't know the scriptures, you make errors. It's you err because you don't know the scriptures. And when you err by not knowing the scriptures, you become like a madman. You speak crazy things spiritually, things that are spiritually crazy. Like, how can a Christian be praying that God keeps him at night in Abraham's bosom? As if it was a place of protection in the first place. As we travel, we pray that you keep us in the bosom of our Father Abraham. A battle of contradiction, a prayer so full of ignorance. A product of wrong pastoring. Oh, glory to God. Jesus walked on this earth and he heard the cries of all humanity. And he answered that. And today, the reason he has sat, listen, is because he has fulfilled. There is nothing the church will do that will add glory to Jesus. Do you know that? The performance of the church on the earth will not add anything to the glory of Christ. Christ has finished his ministry. It is to us now. So what we are doing, the success of the church on the earth will add glory to the church. It is our time to decide who and what. Jesus decided who and what he was going to be, and he has become it. He has become the right hand of the Father. And we, carrying out ministry based on his finished ministry, we are deciding what we are going to be. And please let me tell you this. We are not going to be equal in heaven or in the life we have. No. We're not. The glorious, I posted something you don't know, my status. I said, if God were to answer all your prayers and give you everything you're asking for, would you be more rich eternally or in time? Like the answers to all your prayer, do they make you eternally rich or rich in time? Car, house, money, boyfriend, man friend. You see? And God answers all that. Some of you, your prayer items, 95% come of things. Things that are treasured. Someone is crying for souls. Someone is crying for an ability to obey the word. Look at the prayers of Paul. They were all spiritual. Did you ever see where Paul prayed that they prosper in their business? Isolated places. Some of the apostles did. John did. I pray that above all you may prosper in being healthy, even as thy soul prospers. So the prosperity of the soul is still the foundation. We've missed the target of our fathers. He says, remove not the ancient landmarks which thy fathers have set. And that's what we just done. Our fathers set landmarks, but we've removed them. Principles and pillars. They were focused on Christ. Their focus was Christ. That's ministry. And because of that, but today I want you to understand where ministry is left. Why in the world are we in this thing called ministry? We saw a post a few days ago, last church was there. Now, because if it's about souls, 100 million cannot buy souls. You see that now? If it's about perfecting of the saints, because I have money, doesn't mean the saints are perfected. This is why, please listen and listen well. This is why God will never give certain things to certain of his ministers that he so passionately loves. Because if he gives them, it moves them out of the purpose. Tells me two things. It means this man was not called in the first place. He found ministry as a business. And now he has what he's looking for. There's no reason to be in ministry anymore. After we have those Range Rovers and we can park them, can we still drive them to church? I told you something in church. There used to be times, I remember a particular day, I footed to Boramikare. The edge was to go there and pray. No place seemed conducive. I walked, when I arrived at Eastwood, I was very tired. Not so good at footing. I was tired, I stayed at Eastwood for some minutes. The only solution was for me to come back. But I'm like, it's already half down. I walked. To be very honest with you, when I arrived, the only thing that I wanted was to rest and go back. But what kept me still, not to start off, was that I was going to foot again. So let me still be here as a way of resting. But if I start off now, I'm going back to the same journey. And tired, I began to pray. I prayed, I finished. One particular time, it dawned on me when I went to Borani Garden, I parked my car. Then it dawned to me that I used to be coming here footing. I had something to begin prayer with. I said, God, the same boy who used to be footing coming here is here again even though he's driving. I said, I love you, and God cannot say no. You know what that means? That means we have just despised this physical just to be here. We have looked into his eyes and says, no, you don't decide my love for God. You go there, but you're going to find people parking vehicles. Go at lunch hour. Vehicles. What are they looking for? There are people who go in that place. Trust you me. If you meet them and the gospel you're giving them is to make money, they're not interested. They have money. And that's why I believe personally I have an open space in the body of Christ. Because my message is not prosperity. I have a message for the rich. What are you going to tell somebody that is very rich? Doesn't have Christ. If you share gospel, it's gospel. What are you going to tell? God will give you what? Money, the money that I have. Huh? If you go to CB right now, guy has money. Do you want to preach to him? If the model of your message is God will make you successful, which success is he looking for? The man is successful. There is something about our ministry that the world cannot provide. In the climax of his riches and of his glory, that's the salvation of souls. And if we build our message on that, we have a place. I want you to lift your right hand. We stop there for the day. Next class, we're going to move into more details. believers are going to access these words afterwards. May the Spirit of God right now set your heart on fire.
Yes.
May He realign your passions and your pursuits.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus. He says, he that wants to follow me must forget himself. He says, and bear his own cross. This is my prayer for you. And by the power of the Holy Ghost,
yes,
may that grace be released into your hearts.
Yes.
If you have ever felt uncomfortable, but let that be a very greater sense of the same, but of the gospel of Christ.
Amen.